Thank you for the beautiful music. I'd like to start by maybe having a short conversation with you about the piece. I'd like to start that way because your facility is wonderful, your piano playing is expressive, and the technical capacity that you just demonstrated is more than sufficient to play Beethoven, which is one of the hard virtuoso composers. So perhaps we should talk about some of the surprises involved in this piece. Do you, when I say surprise, can you perhaps give us an example of a passage or a moment when you started to learn this piece where you felt very surprised? That's a good example. Yeah. And how does that go? Can you demonstrate that for the audience for us? At the beginning of the piece, at this particular passage, what does he write? Can you play that for us? So, for those of you who are experienced with Beethoven, or perhaps for new listeners, this bum, 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 bum. That's a common musical gesture. And now the example that you told us before in the recapitulation where you felt surprised. Exaggerate it a little bit for us. Make us really feel that something just went wrong. Like a kind of Looney Tunes version of it. A real surprise. Which is early romantic, and this is what Beethoven's playing with. He's playing with every stereotype that already exists in the music. He's playing games with you, the listener, all the time. So what I'd like you to do now is do that one last time, and I want you to really exaggerate. I want you to go into an extreme space. But I want this A-flat that you're performing for us, I want it to be very extreme, because it is. Yeah. Why don't you take a little bit more headway? You know, that might help you. Why don't you start with a recapitulation? Yeah. Very surprised by what just happened. But it's a point that I'd like to make, actually throughout this piece. Actually, if you don't mind, I'd like to start from the very beginning now, because I think there are so many surprises on the first page that perhaps we can look at those. Before we do that, can you tell us what Beethoven writes in front of the score in terms of the character distinction and the tempo?
He writes Allegro con brio, which is Allegro with spirit, I think. Spirit in Allegro.
Yeah, I think that's a good translation. Allegro con brio, which is Italian for Allegro, or fast, with spirit. That's how I would translate it. So, and you have a solid tempo. It's true. Your tempo is technically allegro. I wonder though if there could be a little bit more con brio. Why don't you just play just the first four bars, and after that just stop, but in a very spirited, in a spirited and playful way. And you, it can just, this is now free. Don't feel like you have to perform now for any. In any specific way, I just want you to play the first four bars in a fantastic, spirited, unforgettable way. Okay, yeah, good. Okay, and I'd like you to repeat that now, and then when you continue, in my opinion, what's about to come, the fifth bar, it's already the first major surprise of the piece. Because in terms of classical music, it's unusual to have this harmonic progression. Could you play that for us? Actually, just the three chords you performed. The sinking harmony comes as a surprise. So if you can perform that for us in a way that really surprises us, then I would be pleased. And then there are these things. Just this. The meaning of that, the musical meaning of this kind of thing. It's electric. Beethoven is extremely specific as a composer, so it ends with a staccato. So it's not. Absolutely not. It's one of the remarkable things about Beethoven. He was absolutely just obsessive about detail. So the gestures, electricity, it's an electric shock. It's like you put your finger into the socket, you know. Thank you. that Beethoven takes control of how this should be performed. So there's, he writes pianissimo. And in a way, that makes it even more electric. If I could issue one last critique, I think that the electricity could be much more intense if you play the whole thing pianissimo. Until you're allowed to make a crescendo. But I think let's continue, because we can continue now where there also has been pianissimo. And then there's this tremor. So instead of this gesture you've already heard, it turns into a tremor, and, you know, the beginning of a serious earthquake. So let's hear that. Crescendo to piano. And it's everywhere in this piece. It's the trope of this sonata specifically. And the first one just happened. There's the music you played, and then there's a surprise harmonic shift. And I'm even right here, as you know. And then at the surprise harmonic shift, you're allowed to play a crescendo. But then Beethoven is very strict and mean, and then there's a, what's called a subito piano. So the music has to immediately be quiet again. And that's electric, you know, that's stimulating. So I think the piano here needs to be, I think, yeah. I'll let you start where you feel comfortable. Experience more of the sonata. Something that I think is an extremely useful tool in performing music is the micro timing. And micro timing can help you with dynamics. And there are already two places where I think that you could, you're playing with really profit from using miniature timing to help you with dynamics. And the first is where we started. May I sit down one more time? First is where we started. Okay. piano playing. It's just part of life as a pianist. The second theme has the melody here. Of course, at the beginning. So that's quite clear and audible. And then later you have to play. So I understand that you have to play a million other things. Why don't you just play us the left hand chorale here, just alone? Is that okay? Beautiful, that's beautiful. And why don't you embellish it now? But maintain that focus on the melody. One of the enjoyable things to do while practicing, not struggle with the fast notes, but to really concentrate on voicing. Yeah, and if you want to hear that, I can demonstrate it for you. What I mean by that is, it's one of the nice ways to practice the piano. Thank you for always standing up. Now I think let's have, I'm afraid because of the masterclass format, I think we're going to just stick to what's called the exposition today, which is the beginning of the sonata, but it repeats. So it's not the end of the world if we just stick to the first three pages, because actually the entire piece is comprised of those materials. So let's continue until we get around here. What I'd like you to do here is, if possible, show us the harmonic chaturanga. And what I mean by that is, in fact, if you could play the chords so that everyone can hear how the chord structure gets faster and faster, that would be brilliant. So if you could highlight that drama, if you could really exaggerate that so that we hear that as lively as spirited as it is. Now you're welcome to play the text as it is. Subject that we already discussed, the crescendo into piano. And at the end here, Beethoven does it four times in a row. It's almost, it's another joke. I mean, he's obsessive. And you did a very good job, I think, on about two of them. Da 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 da. And it's an awkward place. He writes the piano in the wrong place. And that's part of the music. And you know that, because I know you performed some of them well, but it, you know, it, be strict, make sure that it's, you know. And the final word I'd like to say about this is that I think you're on your way to a wonderful Waldstein, and I don't recommend that you remain cautious with your tempo, because this is not cautious music. It's actually crazy music. And so you're there, and your technical capacity is wonderful, but it's time, I think, to focus more on the brio, and to really shock your listeners. That was Beethoven's thing, and so that's for you to have fun with. Yeah. Thank you very much. Bye.
So just a reminder, these classes are being recorded, and we have a lot of external noise to deal with, so the more we can keep quiet in the room, the better. That's much appreciated. Please welcome Rebecca Tseng to the stage, who's going to perform music by Liszt.
Touching and with a core sound, a lyrical singing sound that I enjoyed very much. And I also want to say that I enjoyed their natural expressivity, which is crucial, of course, to this kind of music. So you express the not just the atmosphere of the piece, but also the gestures. You know, the melodic gestures are clearly intentioned by the way you play, which I cherish a lot. Yeah. So you've worked on this. This is a music that you know very well, I can tell. Have you played this piece for a long time?
3 months.
Oh yeah. Okay. Perfect. Well, that's not very long. What I'd like to do, actually, first I'd like to say that we were just in the Viennese classic you know, context, Beethoven, what they called, back then they called Sturm und Drang, so storm, dramatic, yeah, stormy music. And that was the beginning of the Romantic era, and now we're deeply into the Romantic era. You can hear that with the lyricism and with the, this is inspired by bel canto, Italian singing. So it's a different style in that sense. And what I've noticed helps me a lot in order to find even clearer structure is to do things that may seem unmusical at first, but I'm going to ask you today if we can experiment with this piece. Yeah. What I'd like to do, my ultimate goal is to unlock even more of your expressive potential. And in order to do that, what I'd like to do is not play the piece the way it's supposed to be played, but to play it a couple of different ways. And the reason for that is that the expressivity that you're working on, that you're so, you're succeeding in doing, that you're trying to convey, is it's in its own framework. It's you play the piece now a certain way. And what I'd like to do is unlock maybe a little bit of possibility for you to be able to play the piece with a little bit more breathing room, you know, a little bit more of an improvisatory feeling to the music, to express it this way today and to express it this way another day, to, you know, to stretch a little bit within the music. Does that make sense? Yeah, I think that will help. And ironically, it's not just fast music that needs to be practiced slowly. I think that actually expressive or slow music benefits from being practiced fast. The reason for that is because you can arch, you can find an overarching structure. And so that's what I'd like to try to do with you today. In fact, I think we could start, and I don't think we'll start with, there's one page which serves as an introduction to the piece. And so I don't think we'll start there. What I'd like to do is start with the melody, if that's okay. And what we need to do is find, yeah, let's do with this first page of the melody. And I'll let you look at the score, because I'm going to ask you to do a few different things. I'd like you to play this actually very fast. And I don't need you to worry too much about the triplets, for example. You can hint at some of the harmonies, or you can try to play them. But let's pretend that this is supposed to be almost like a waltz-like piece. Dun, 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 dun. I know, it's quite fast. You want to try? Yeah, I've enjoyed that so far, yeah. Good work. The thing about a fast tempo for slow music is that you do hear the moments when you really want to express something. And it's a shame that you have to go quickly by. So be a little bit... in this fast tempo, enjoy some of these. So show those to us, even though you have to play quickly. Does that make sense? And then go ahead and keep going, actually. If you can, try to play the whole first page. Yeah. Intention of the composer, but that doesn't matter right now. It's music. Music is music. If it sounds good, it sounds good. I learned a few things about this piece just now by you playing it in a fast tempo. For example, that the melody starts and then it repeats itself, which is a common structure.
structure in music. And then there's this interesting syncopation. So the second half of the melody starts with a syncopation, doesn't it? Yeah.
And I'm just saying that because I didn't notice that in the slow version. It would have been noticeable. I could have noticed it, but I only noticed it now. So
these details emerge. Why don't you play this just for our own entertainment, if possible, at an even faster tempo, just for fun, and try to leave out, imply the chords, if possible. Don't play all of the accompanimental material, just hint at the harmonies. Does that make any sense? Yeah. Something, a whole different character. Try this tempo, and may I sit down? Try this tempo, but change the way that your accompaniment, that you play the accompaniment. So for example, you could play. What Liszt does, it's typical for a virtuoso pianist, he continues to write lyrical music, but it's interrupted by a lot of, not filigree, but with a lot of ornamentation, with a lot of accompanimental figuration. So if you could play from here to here, somehow just enough material so that we hear the melody and the harmonies, I would be interested. If possible, just imply the harmonies and play the melody. And then also, don't worry about the fermatas. Let's pretend like this. We don't need the fermatas either. We just need the melody, the harmonies, and hear the whole structure of it. Is that okay? Because you can play the piece, I think it would be good if you could also just play the harmony. Can I sit down one final time? I'm not a very great sight reader, but it's just... It's hard. I'm asking you to do something very challenging, which, as I already said, is not very nice because you can play piece. So, but what it boils down to is that there's all this material, all this virtuoso piano music that embellishes these 8 or 12 bars of melody. And this melody has a beginning and it has an end, and there's a climax in this passage. And so it's, you know, it's like anything, there's structure. And for example, where is the climax, in your opinion? In this passage. Actually, harmonically speaking, you've already arrived there. There, exactly. Yeah. So there's a melody, and it unfolds over 8 bars, and on the downbeat of bar 6, there you've arrived at the arrival point. And that kind of knowledge is not. That kind of knowledge is audible when you perform. If you solidly know and understand that, then that's just. It's audible in your playing. Then everyone feels clear about what's happening. There's no vagueness. It's clear. When you arrive there, all the listeners understand too. Oh, we've arrived, and that's satisfying as a listener to have that experience. That's why I think it's important to practice these kind of harmonic reductions. And after all, because you can play the piece, it's good if you find other ways to practice it. Yeah, if you practice it the same way all the time, it's just, you might as well learn a new piece, you know. I'd like to talk about one other thing. Why don't you play this page? For us. Is that okay? And let's listen to that again. This is when the theme returns. So this is back to the main theme. Thank you. to work on something, but I couldn't stop you because you were playing so beautifully. So we got to enjoy the end of the piece again. So I hope that was pleasurable for everybody.
Yes.
You play beautifully. And what I enjoy, as a listener, it's always comforting when there's rhythmic clarity, which we definitely receive here. Can you play for everyone just the beginning of this so they hear what I mean? So this passage is very enjoyable to hear, but the melody is beautiful, and there's clarity. It's clear what's going on rhythmically. More challenging are the passages like this, where the accompaniment doesn't give you as much rhythm. And on top of that, the melody is very freely composed, so there's a lot of embellishment within the melody. So if what I'd like to ask you to do, just for an experiment for all of us, is play this again. Dun, 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 dun. And why don't you play the chords the way they're written, but also give us quarter notes in the bass somehow so that we hear exactly what the rhythm is. Does that make any sense? So if you play everything that's written, but also play it again. Dun, dun, dun. Does something which is absolutely metric. I don't mean it won't change tempo, but it has to change tempo steadily. It's up to you to decide exactly when to start, and if you're going to slow down a lot or not very much. But without this inner basis, it's hard for the listener to understand what's going on. Does that make sense? Yeah. Would you like to try one more time? Decisions that have to be made, and they're not easy to make. So this is something that you can maybe spend some time thinking about. For example, now I think my decision would be to tempo has to change, it has to be flexible, and rubato is beautiful. The thing that I don't find beautiful is when the tempo suddenly cuts in half. Because then the listeners are lost. Yeah. And I'm not accusing you of doing this, actually. But I do think that preparing these cadenzi, you know, it takes this kind of calculated rhythmic thinking. Because if it's prepared right and takes the tempo, then the gesture is magnificent. And everyone's just in awe because of that preparation. Because you lay the foundation for this event, you know. Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah. Very good. I believe we have a couple more minutes. Yeah, so just for fun, just to say thank you again, why don't you play, because we've heard the melody a few times now, and we've talked a lot about rhythm, what I'd like to hear you play just to conclude is the introduction, so before the melody. And think a little bit about these rhythmic structures, and in fact, if you play it rather strictly, then I think we might hear the structure of this instrument.